Well, good evening, and thank you very much for coming. I would like to talk about Russia surveillance state, and it's a joint project conducted by previous international citizen lab and agentura.ru. And who we are? So the previous international is a UK-based well-known charity that defends the privacy rights and promote the right to privacy across the world. And the Citizen Lab is the organization based in the Munk School of Global Affairs within the University of Toronto in Canada, and focusing on advancing research and development at the intersection of digital media and global security and human rights. And agentura.ru, and I'm editor of this website, is a Russian Secret Services watchdog founded in September 2000 as a community of investigative journalists. And I myself, I'm an investigative journalist for more than 13 years, and for 12 years I've been covering the activities of the Russian security services, I mean counterterrorism operations, terrorist attacks in Moscow, in the North Caucasus, hostage takings, espionage cases, any kind of activities for Russian security services were so famous for the last 12, 15 years. And why we started this project? Some years ago, something about 2008, 2009, we've noticed that the Russian government and the Russian authorities, under the leadership of the president Dmitry Medvedev, so it's not directly connected to Vladimir Putin, started to pay more attention to surveillance technologies and at the same time to the so-called fighting against extremism. And in my country, fighting against extremism is quite a broad term, because sometimes it means the fighting against political opponents or any kind of activist. And for us, it was quite a strange coincidence that at the same time, the Russian authorities started to invest money to developing of surveillance technologies, and at the same time, the special department on fighting extremism was created on the place of the department charged with fighting organized crime. And when I told you about that Medvedev started to pay personally attention to surveillance technologies, I mean such thing like the famous Commission of Modernization of Russia. This commission was created by Dmitry Medvedev, and this commission was famous for creating a list of tasks for modernization of Russia. And this list is a kind of list of goals and tasks for the Russian government and for the Russian state, what should be done to make the country more modernized. And 2 points in this list were proposed by the Federal Security Service, by the FSB, the Russian main security service. And these points were about video recognition, face recognition, and about speech recognition. So the aims of our project with previous International Citizen Lab is to undertake research and investigation into surveillance practices in Russia, including trade and in use of surveillance technologies, and to publicize research and investigative findings. Why it's not just our Russian problem? There's a lot of things that might be said about it, but I decided to focus on only three main points. In 2012, Russia introduced the internet censorship legislation, which requires from ISPs, internet service providers, to install DPI, deep packet inspection, technology on the nationwide scale. And that legislation took in force this November. Second point is Russian approach to so-called LI, lawful interception. And the next thing is that Russian companies enjoy the leading positions in some areas of surveillance technologies worldwide. And let me talk about these things in more details. First thing and first point is DPI in Russia. It's quite a complicated thing, and you see here supplies and installations. I just wanted to show you that all biggest world supplies of DPI technologies are already in Russia. More of that, biggest Operators in Russia already installed DPI technologies even before the legislation of this November. And the problem here that it's not directly connected to political will of the Russian government. It was made firstly purely of commercial reasons, so it's mostly a commercial thing, and most of this technology, most of equipment, DPI equipment, was introduced in 2010-2011 because mobile phone operators wanted to make sure that they might suppress unwanted traffic, such as torrents and Skype. So the introduction of DPI technologies happened in Russia not because of political pressure, but because mobile operators wanted to present special tariff plans for customers and to make sure that they can shape traffic and they might suppress the traffic they don't want to broadcast. So it mostly coincided with the introduction of mobile internet, when in Russia we could buy USB things to connect to the internet, your laptop or your devices. And the problem here that now, when the Russian state started to request the internet service providers to use DPI equipment not to shape traffic, but to block access to content that considered by the Russian state as harmful or illegal, it's became quite difficult to question the policy of Western providers of such technologies, because firstly, they sold this stuff to Russia because it was a commercial demand. And you see that now we have all these big companies in Russia, a lot, and Vimpelcom is mobile phone operator, Sundivine, Canadian Sundivine, it's installed in Rostelecom, and Rostelecom is a Russian analog of British Telecom, for example, so it's nationwide operator. MTS, it's the second biggest mobile phone operator in Russia, and Cisco is there. And Procera, again, made in the United States, in Vimpelcom, and Huawei is installed in Megaphones. This is the third mobile phone operator in Russia. The strange thing now is we got a kind of scandal around DPI, but it's mostly not about that internet community in Russia are really concerned with privacy and with some dangerous aspects of DPI technology. But because internet service providers are required to buy this stuff themselves, and only mobile operators bought the DPI equipment, and ISPs were quite reluctant to buy this stuff. We might explain it by the nature of the Russian market. The problem is that mobile operators, because they faced the problem of mobile internet, they wanted to buy DPI. And ISP internet service providers from Russia, they mostly provide to customers very simple tariffs, and they just don't need DPI. Now they are forced to buy it, and that's caused the scandal. But not because they are outraged by the Russian new legislation. They just don't want to buy this stuff. So that's why I think it's a very good example how Western surveillance technology might be presented in Russia, and it would be a very complicated thing to try to challenge this policy, because it's, on the one hand, it's commercial, on the other hand, internet service providers and mobile phone operators, they are quite reluctant to contact with activists and with human rights organizations, because their only concern is that they don't want to pay for this equipment. The next thing, and this subject, lawful interception, is connected with DPI, because Russian providers try now to connect DPI with lawful interception. And that might be quite a dangerous development of technology. The problem here that DPI, as maybe you know, allows the internet service providers not just to block access to something, but to identify those who try to connect particular web page, particular services, send some particular emails. For example, already in Russia, DPI used it to identify spammers. And this technology might be used to identify those who try to, for example, talk about protests in their emails. DPI might help to solve the problem of identification of these who try to talk about it. Because law enforcement interception is mostly about, for example, you know the particular person, you want to follow to intercept his communications, so you start with the person. DPI start with the problem. For example, they have the problem of discussion about protest, they use DPI, they identify people, and now they can follow them. So the connection between these two technologies might be too dangerous. And another problem here, and why it might be more dangerous than in the Western countries, that the understanding of lawful interception in Russia, in the West, are quite different. This is a chart that presents the West European version of lawful interception. And what's important here is that you see what law enforcement agency obtaining the warrant send request with the warrant to ISP or phone operator. Operator actually does all interception work and then sends the result of interception to law enforcement agency. The problem is that the Russian scheme of lawful interception is quite different. What we see here, we see so-called control PU is, we might translate as control device. So this control device is installed in the headquarters of the FSB, of the Federal Security Service. There's only one line directly to the lawful interception equipment installed in the servers of ISPs and phone operators, and you see only one line. So the problem here that nobody tried to send the warrant or to show the warrant to internet service provider. According to Russian law, the FSB is obliged to obtain the warrant. The problem is they don't need to show it to anyone, because internet service providers has no secret clearance, so they have no right to access the secret information. The information about warrants considered to be secret, so they have no right to ask. So the problem here that actually internet service providers are responsible only for paying for installment of lawful interception equipment, and that's all. It's a box. It's a box which ISP personnel have no access even to the room where this box is installed. And there's the direct channel between the FSB headquarters and this box. The problem here, what's the main difference between the Russian approach and the Western approach? Right, for example, when the Western, I don't know, MI5 need to intercept someone, they write the special warrant, they list the numbers, the phone numbers of the people that should be intercepted. They obtain the warrant, then they send this thing to ISP, and this is a whole and long bureaucratic procedure. In Russia, you need to write the first draft of the list of intercepted phone numbers, and that would be enough, because then you need just to put this requirements list to the PU, to the control device, and you can obtain it every time you need it. For example, you need to update it to add new numbers. Nobody notices it, just because ISP has no right to know about it, and because there is one channel between the FSB headquarters, PU, and lawful interception equipment in the premises of internet service provider or phone operator. Why this problem is not just Russian problem? The system, call it SORM in Russian, system of search measures, search activities, was developed in the late 80s and first introduced in the late 80s, back in the time of the Soviet Union. And what we got after the collapse of the Soviet Union, that all so-called independent states of the former Soviet Union, they inherited with all Russian things and all Soviet insignia, they also inherited regional branches of the KGB. They also inherited not just branches, not just people, but procedures. And the problem that most of the countries which thought to be completely independent I decided to stick to the Soviet experience in surveillance technologies and in surveillance and conducting of surveillance operations. SORM, the Russian word SORM, is still in use in Belarus, in Ukraine, in Uzbekistan, in Kyrgyzstan, in Kazakhstan. It's just the same system. Might be some technical, tiny requirements might be different, but the system as a whole is the same. And this gives enormous advantages to Russian suppliers of SORM equipment. Because, for example, if you're a Western company, well, you might sell some stuff to Russia or to Uzbekistan or to Kyrgyzstan, but you need to update your equipment because Russian SORM is not equal to lawful interception equipment in the West. Because if you need to produce this PU control device, you need to produce a special channel, blah, 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 so you need to cooperate with the Russian suppliers. And Russian suppliers feel quite happy in all these countries, and sometimes it's even more important than political relationships between Russian authorities and authorities of a particular country. For example, the best example maybe is Uzbekistan. Uzbekistan is not very happy with the Russian presence. They are not part of any of military alliances supported by Russia. And the people and the security services of Uzbekistan are trained in the United States. And if we are talking about equipment, surveillance equipment, they mostly buy this equipment in Israel, but they still use SORM system. The legislation, the rules, the procedures are the same, Russian. So we always have this door to the Russian technologies and to the Russian approach. It already caused some problems in, for example, in Kyrgyzstan, when Kyrgyz government was embarrassed 2 years ago when some telephone conversation of leading politicians were leaked to the internet. And just a month ago, there was information that these leaks were produced, were caused by the Russian interception equipment installed in this country. But the government of Kyrgyzstan, they still think that it's the best way to do the things and surveillance is to follow the Russian example. So what this is one of the problems why it's so important. But what I wanted to say also is that it's not when we are talking about Russian impact on surveillance, we mostly tend to think about the former Soviet Union. The problem is that in some areas, Russian companies and Russian producers of surveillance technologies are so good that they find contracts very far from the former Soviet Union. And the best example is the so-called Speech Technology Center. It's quite a famous company. It's listed in the WikiLeaks project spy files, because they produce very good speech recognition technology, might be the best in the world. The background of this company is quite curious, because it's exactly the same company where Alexander Solzhenitsyn, the famous Soviet dissident, was worked in the 50s. It's the same Gulag secret factory, but just transferred from Moscow to St. Petersburg. And people who work there, they're still very proud of it. They told me it's openly that they remember how Solzhenitsyn worked there, and they have no moral consideration about how it might be understood in the world. And they just sold on nationwide scale the technology of speech identification to Mexico. And now this technology is installed not only in Mexico, but in the Middle East, in Singapore. They try their hand in China, in Colombia, and Ecuador, in many, many other countries. What's the problem here? When these people arrive, and they're very good specialists, when they arrive in the country like Mexico, of course, the first question is that they don't want to buy just technologies. They want to buy the result that this technology would be useful to catch criminals or maybe someone else, like dissidents. And they, all the time, they try to say, okay, it's not enough just to buy equipment. You need to change your procedures. You need to create the system of dissemination of gathered information. And quite smoothly, these people became turned from just suppliers of technology into advisors in security issues. And for example, in Mexico, the whole new police units were format because of the advice of these people. Because these people will know better how to disseminate these technologies, and they just dictated what might be the best, how to collect this information, how to provide this information to investigative units, and how when to collect it in the special databases. So they changed it slightly, the whole police system in the country. And in this case, we are talking not about former Soviet Union, we are talking about Mexico. So that's mostly what I wanted to say today. And maybe, because I think it would be better to be brief, so maybe it's time to give floor to questions.
Okay, thank you very much for the interesting talk. So, are there any questions in the room right now? So you just go behind the mics and ask your question. Or is there a question from the IRC channel, Signal Angel? No question at all. Okay then, at least I have a question. So you said that the Russian internet community is not that concerned about the privacy issues involved in deep packet inspection. As opposed to maybe other internet communities, or did I get that wrong? So why is that?
The problem that for many years Russian authorities show it that they don't want to change the legislation, they don't want to repeat the Chinese approach. Also, they boasted that, that the internet in Russia would be more free than in Central Asia, than in Uzbekistan and China, and they hated the idea that the internet in Russia might be filtered. And the first time when they started slowly to change this approach happened in 2007, but to be frank, it was not, it has not been done systematically. In most cases, it was a sort of a regional initiative. Some small regional court issued a special request to a local ISP asking them to block access to some Chechen website. And that would be just a regional initiative. Nobody repeated in the whole country. Nobody noticed it. And that's why we got quite strange situation when, for example, Kafka Center, the most famous website supported by Chechen rebels, was simultaneously asked to be blocked in many, many regions. But in fact, it was it was available everywhere. And only now, in November, the situation is completely changing, because now we got this single register of sites which should be banned, and which requires all ISPs providers, all operators, long-distance, short-distance operators, to install DPI technologies and to start block access to website. And first time we got the nationwide system. And that's why only now people started to think, started to worry about the problem. One example is that most people only now started to think about anonymizers. And even Tor is quite a new word for Russia. It was, in fact, introduced only this November, and there was a lot of strange talks about Tor, but it might be undercover, underground network of drug dealers, etc., etc. It was quite funny. It was pronounced by liberal journalists, not because we were, well, pro-Kremlin, but just because we don't know what the Tor is.
Thank you. So we have questions in the room now. I'll start with mic two then.
Hi. How did you learn which DPI vendors each ISP is using?
Because I'm a journalist, so I sent requests to ISPs. We have a system of when you can't control some contracts, you can't get information of some contracts, even if ISPs don't want to publish this information. And so that's why we got this information, published it on Wired last month in November.
Okay.
Okay, mic three then, please.
So there was recently a law passed, or recently more enforced, that basically prevents the population from criticizing the government. Have you seen this being used, or this system being used in new ways in recent history?
You mean DPI or law enforcement interception?
Interception.
Yes, we got quite interesting figures just 3 months ago. But in 5 years, the number of legal warrants for interception doubled in Russia, almost doubled. And we got these figures, well, just by chance. And first thing we thought, well, what might be the explanation? Because in most countries, when you see that the number of intercepts are growing, it's explained by reasons of fighting against terrorism or maybe fighting against organized crimes, something like that. In Russia, what was interesting, that when this process began in 2007, that was exactly the year when the Russian authorities stated that the number of crimes started to decline. That's the first thing. The same year, in 2007, the Russian forces said that the counterterrorism operation in Chechnya is over. So they officially stated that the terrorist threat started to decline also. So not just the threat of organized crime, but also the problem of terrorism. And the last thing that we got this information just 2 weeks ago, the Supreme Court of Russia supported the case against political activists who tried to sue the FSB department in one of the Russian towns, because the FSB department there put the guy under surveillance just because the activist went to the political manifestation questioning the broadening powers of the FSB itself. And the Supreme Court supported the FSB and said it was right, it was legal to intercept for 180 days all traffic, all phone calls, and even physically, and even physical surveillance of the activist, just because the guy took part in the manifestation questioning the policies of the FSB. So he was never accused of anything. He was never charged. But the Supreme Court decided that was right.
Okay, then we have a question from the internet.
All right, the first question is, how does DPI affect internet performance? Is it noticeable?
Excuse me?
Can you repeat the question?
Yes. How does DPI affect internet uplink performance? Is it noticeable?
Well, in fact, as far as I understand, many people try to say that it might somehow affect the speed of internet connection, but in fact, we didn't see any such problems, and internet service providers, the biggest ones like Rostelecom, claim it that the channels are quite big and you cannot sense these things, and that's why it's sensed only by users of mobile internet. Because now, if you use Russian mobile phone, there is a you can choose the option. You can choose the speed of internet connection. It's if you pay more, you get the biggest speed. But it's only consequence. You cannot test it, these things if you use internet at your home or at office.
Okay. Then next question from Mike 2.
I wanted to know if you knew something about it, at what stage they are in the deployment of DPI devices in Russia, as in doing some brief measurements just from some points in Russia. I understand that they are currently doing it only on an IP basis. So do you see that, like, do you think they will do the next step soon? And do you know, like, how much they have started rolling this out and with what sort of level of granularity?
As far as I understand, the biggest discussion, the most important discussion, took place in September, when all biggest operators and providers, and even Google, debated this issue with the Ministry of Communications. And they thought about IP, then they thought about pages. And as far as I understand today, they even thought about how to use caching technologies like peer up technologies, for example, to filter video on YouTube, because the normal DPI cannot help you to block a particular video on YouTube, but caching system, caching technologies might be of some use. So that's why now they proceed to introduce these caching technologies.
But are you aware of at what stage they, like, are you aware of some ISP that is doing it, for example?
Well, the list I presented, all of them started to use these things. So it's quite certain. They stated this even in their statements, in their official statements. So it's open. So called biggest free mobile phone operators, and in Russia they also provide mobile internet and fixed internet. They started to use these things on more.
But what I mean is that they are actually using some rules on top of it, like not just that they have caching proxies that are doing HTTP caching, but that they also are applying rules on top of it.
Well, I think I was told only about caching things. So, well, there's a lot of talks about, for example, maybe we need to think now about VPN, to do something with VPN in Russia, on the example of Pakistan. But it's mostly about rumors. It's not about, I don't have any documents to support that any decisions were taken.
Okay, question on mic three.
Yes, thank you very much. Bolshaya Spaspio. You talked about, if I understood you correctly, that from Uzbekistan, certain data had reached Russian intelligence services from interception in...
Not Uzbekistan, Kyrgyzstan.
Kyrgyzstan, all right, sorry. You were talking about how systems working after the Russian model are being deployed in countries in Latin America. You mentioned Mexico. Is there any evidence, or are there any hints to support that data intercepted in these countries may find their way to Russian agencies?
Well, the only allegation was made in Kyrgyzstan, and it was about two devices. One phone taping device, but to be frank, it was not very serious because it was of enterprise level. It was a kind of device that was installed in the building of the government, so it's not very serious. It's not about, but so it might be about how to intercept phone calls of government employees, but it's not about population. And second device was it was a SORM device installed in 2008. But as far as I understand, it's the only allegations, and the producers and the suppliers of these technologies told us that it was an intergovernment decision to install these devices, but they denied all kind of allegations and say that they have no access, etc. So by now, I cannot say for sure that the information collected in this country might be... So, of course, it's... It gives the Russian authorities a good position in these countries just because we can, for example, travel to this country as advisors and to advise how to use such technologies. But to say that we actually connect the surveillance equipment in this country to Moscow center, I think it's to say too far.
Thank you.
Okay, then an IRC question, please.
The second question. Whether they do both speech recognition for content analysis and pinning conversations on individual, and how you can be contacted?
How many?
The last bit was how you can be contacted.
Contacted?
Yes.
By whom?
By people with questions, I think.
They might visit the website of agentur.ru, send me a mail, but in fact they might go to the webpage of this speech technology center. Is it both in Russian and in English? They became quite famous because of the revelation and because they were put in the list of spy files project of WikiLeaks. So you can find a lot of information about them. Well, they became quite secret now because they don't want to give comments about these things because we have an American outlet and they don't want to be accused of anything wrongdoing. But in fact, well, you can go to their websites and to get some initial information.
Okay, then we'll go on with the room first. Mic two.
You have said that DPI technology was installed for commercial purposes first, blocking BitTorrent and Skype, and was later used in the massive surveillance system SORM. You have only briefly touched how it was used for censoring websites, which went into effect in November. What is by definition supposed to be censored? What is defined as extremist? And was there political speech censored? And what cases of overblocking were there, like instead of a single site blocking an entire domain?
Well, actually, the legislation was ostensibly all about protection of children. And of course, it was quite funny. For example, the idea was that we need to block all websites that you might find child pornography. And then the next thing was that we need to block all websites that you might find information about how to commit suicide. And then people started to ask, well, if I'm, for example, adult, and I would like to commit my suicide, so why I would be not allowed to go to this website? And, well, ostensibly because it's all about protection of children. There is no children here, just about adults who want to commit suicide. Why he is not allowed to go to this website? But the problem is that also, so there is a three points in the law. One is about child pornography, second is about committing suicides and propagation of suicides, and the third point is about drugs. But in fact, there is a fourth point, and this is the most important and the most dangerous, because there is a point about, but also, you can, the register would consist of the websites which found illegal by Russian courts. So the first three things, the information about the first three categories would be put in the register without any court decisions, just because some guys in the Ministry of Interior or in the Federal Anti-Drug Agency might decide that this site is not very good. But the third thing might be more important, because Russian courts tend to find illegal a lot of websites which actually have nothing to do with chat pornography or etc. etc. We have a long record for many years, until maybe since 2007, when a lot of websites were found illegal, but in fact, because ostensibly they are extremists, but in fact, it was mostly about political activity. For example, some political organization was found by the court illegal, so all websites of this organization would be found illegal. And of course, you cannot find anything extremist on these websites, but the access would be blocked. So it was used to suppress some political discussions. For example, the very latest example. Everybody knows the case of Pussy Riot. So now the Russian court found that all three videos of Pussy Riot should be banned. So it's not about child pornography, it's not about committing suicide or drugs, but it's found illegal and it's banned now in Russia.
Okay, thank you. Mic 3 then.
Hello, привет. I would like to know, to what extent does the FSB or its affiliates engage in routine surveillance of foreign nationals when they're in the territory of the Russian Federation or its friendly states? Just for example, myself, I'm basically nobody important or interesting, really. I have no public profile, not politically involved, but I may next year spend a couple months just basically living there and hanging out and working remotely for an American company, maybe using a regular cell phone, and also not particularly paranoid. I like to be paranoid, but I just find it takes up too much time, so. Simpler to be less paranoid, but really, just is there a realistic chance that my traffic will be just monitored in some routine way and maybe looked at by some human being? And anything I should concerns I should be expressing to my employer? Thank you very much.
Okay.
Well, because of the latest development between Russia relationship between Russia and United States, right? You might be not so paranoid, but in fact the problem is that when we are talking about surveillance and especially interception in Russia, now from maybe 2010, we are talking not only about the FSB, because in fact it's also quite ominous development. Since the early 90s, it was decided quite quietly, but that according to the law, 8 agencies in Russia have the right to intercept phone calls and internet traffic. But the FSB would put in charge to technically conduct these kind of operations and then to disseminate the information to other agencies. What we get now, since 2010, that all other agencies, for example, what we found, it was quite, well, really strange thing. I can't explain it why we decided to do it in this way. the Federal Prison Service, which is responsible for guarding inmates, we started to buy storm equipment and install them not in prisons, but on telephone stations in the towns. And nobody understands. I tried to send an official request. I was told that it's all completely secret and it cannot be debated. But in fact, what we got now, that a lot of parallel systems of surveillance now in existence in Russia, because it's not only about the FSB, it's also about interception capabilities of Interior Ministry, about the interception system of anti-drug agency and the prison service, at least. So you might decide yourself. So maybe you might be put under surveillance, but it would be not necessarily the FSB. It might be some other services.
Хорошо.
Okay, then we go on with a question from the IRC.
Are there Russian activists that educate people how to counter DPI and by using things like Tor?
No. Maybe because human rights organizations and activists were not really ready for such dramatic shift in Russian policies, because as I told, for 20 years Russian government and Russian authorities stated that they never followed the Chinese approach on the internet, and just suddenly this summer they changed completely their approach to the internet. Even after the Arab Spring, when the FSB started to say something about we need to counter the Arab Spring, we need to counter the social networks, actually they failed. For example, the most famous example, when we tried to counter the problem of disseminating of information about protests in social networks, was in December, at the time of the first protest, when the FSB department in St. Petersburg sent a written request signed by the chief of the FSB department to the guy who is in charge of contacts, it's a Russian version of Facebook, asking him to remove some protest groups. Of course it was published, of course it had caused a big scandal, and everybody think that the FSB are completely crazy and they don't know what to do with social networks. And then suddenly we got this new legislation. So human rights organization activists, they are not ready, in fact, to provide any kind of assistance, any kind of help to other activists, what to do with the DPI, and even, as I told, even Tor is quite a new thing in Russia now.
Okay, then, Mike too.
Coming from the UK, I'm not used to such good civil rights as we have in Germany, particularly for political protest and the like. Typically, when you go on a protest in Britain, there's a low level of intimidation with being video cameraed and the like. And there's the next stage of political intimidation when people turn up at your door knocking, etc. What you've been talking about is the surveillance, the issues of things that I can correspond going back the years to things like Indie Media in Oxford having their servers seized so that all the IP addresses could be found, which is a more primitive technology. What worries me even more is the next stage that happens after they've started doing the trawling, the intimidation that happens to prevent people being politically active. Is there much that's documented that can be traced to deep packet inspection, to this mass surveillance of internet traffic, and documented that it's directly a consequence of this that people have been further politically intimidated?
Well, I cannot say that specifically DPI technology was used to intimidate political activists. I might say that other technologies, surveillance technology, were already used, especially in January and spring of 2012 and December 2011, when, for example, some technologies were used to crack emails of activists. And they leaked to the internet and used by pro-government media. And at the same time, we got a lot of opposition gates when law enforcement interception systems were used to intercept phone calls of the leading opposition leaders, and when it was leaked again to the pro-government media, and when the FSB used these videos and these audio transcripts as a pretext to open the criminal case against the opposition leaders. And I think that, and what has warned me, that DPI might be the next step. But as far as I know by now, it's mostly this kind of, mostly FSB now, based the activity on lawful interception, not on DPI. So, but the DPI might be the next step.
Okay, Mike 4.
Hello. I would like actually to make a small transition because there will be another talk about Russian security systems at 8:30, and I'm the speaker. And actually there is something which I would like you to comment on. It's an interesting event for which I have no explanation, but basically there was an attack published on the Russian ghost cipher at certain moment in 2011 at FSE conference. And the presenters were polite enough not to say that basically like ghost is broken, so they didn't actually use that word. So the first person who had used that word, that ghost is broken, was me on a website, so I have put it on the website, ghost is broken. Mm-hmm. And quite interestingly, after that, within 30 seconds, I had three connections, one from the United States, one from Russia, and one from Ukraine, and after that, the web server was down for reasons never explained and was down for a long time. And I wonder, so there's no proof there is anything dodgy going on here, but I thought it was an interesting event, and could you comment on that?
Well, to be frank, I tried to investigate the claims that the Russian state might be behind some big hackers attacks, DDoS attacks on, you know, there is plenty of them during the last few years, like on Estonia, on Georgian websites, and Lithuania, and so on and so on and so on. And mostly it was detected that attacks were directed from Russia. The problem was to establish the proof that these attacks were helped by, for example, by technology provided by the security services, or by that the state resources were used to attack the websites of these countries. The problem actually was that this system is smarter than we thought of it, because we thought that it really happened because some technical support was provided from the state. But in fact, it was mostly about hacktivism. A lot of people were just given free hand to attack websites of, for example, of Estonian and Georgian guys. And that gives Russian authorities the regime of, they might deny all accusations quite happily, because in fact there is no connection, there is no proof that they somehow involved in these attacks. And last year I visited the NATO Cybersecurity Center in Estonia, and they admitted that in fact it was not about DDoS attacks, it was mostly about DOS attacks. And that in fact what we understood by the Russian authorities and some people, for example the administration of president, might just inspire a lot of people using very traditional methods of mobilizing youth to attack some websites. And in this case, technology would be very simple, and this simple technology would be much more dangerous, because in this case you can't establish any connection between the attackers and the state.
Okay, then mic 2, or mic 3, sorry.
Do you know how much bandwidth actually does this system trace and filter? Or an order of magnitude?
Well, I'm sorry, I'm not a technical specialist, I'm just a journalist.
But, so you said that the ISPs have to purchase the equipment, which means that they cannot have any links that are not actually, that don't go through this equipment, right?
Yeah.
So all the bandwidth in Russia is actually goes through these devices and through the system, and can be controlled and analyzed.
Can you repeat your question, because I don't quite, I'm not very technically advanced, and I'm quite sorry for that.
So, to paraphrase it, is there any connection in Russia that I can use to talk to someone over the internet that's not going through these devices?
No, because in fact all ISPs are required to install lawful interception, and at the same time when we started to build DPI equipment, I was told and I got proof that in Siberian regions and in some regions in Far East, they already started to combine already existed SORM equipment with DPI technologies. And the problem is that SORM are everywhere. You just cannot provide any kind of services without lawful interception equipment. It's just one of the line in your license. So if you are not follow the license, you cannot be an operator in Russia. So there is no way to avoid these things.
So do you have any idea if this actually hinders the growth of the internet in Russia? Is this a problem for the growth, for the upgrade of links and everything like that?
As far as I see, no. It seems to be, well, I don't see any connections. I don't see that this kind of equipment might prevent Russian ISPs to get more capabilities. Or to
no, I mean, it costs some money, so it harms them in some way. But is it too expensive for?
Well, in fact, well, we might be too deep inside the Russian telecommunications market, but the old Soviet system of the Ministry of Telecommunications and of state-controlled operators are still quite alive, because the biggest operators in Russia are not, for example, foreign operators or small ISPs which grown up to some levels. There's former state-owned operators. That's why they enjoy the very cheap access to this land, long line operators, and that's why we have they might provide cheaper services. And so that's why what we have now is the biggest operators are former state-controlled operators, and for them it's not a big problem with this kind of expenses.
Thank you, and thank you for your courage.
Thank you.
We still have time for one, maybe two questions from the internet, so go ahead.
This one. Question, we're probably off topic, but what about some information about Kaspersky or the relation to FSB in the context of the Russian surveillance state?
Very good question. I might direct you to the excellent profile published a few months ago on Wired about Kaspersky. The problem with Kaspersky is that he is actually former KGB officer, and he maintains some of prejudices of the KGB people. It's not only about patriotism. It's mostly, I think it's more dangerous. It's not all things about patriotism and Soviet things, etc., etc. The most important thing that KGB people, they don't believe in any kind of horizontal structures. They always believe in what, in so-called order. And they hate any kind of disorder of the internet, for example. That's why Kaspersky is very insistent to present his view how the internet should be governed. And the last 2 years, his point of view coincided with the point of view of Russia. And the latest Russian initiative on the United Nations, that you maybe know, in ITU, to change the way how the internet is governed, is fully supported by Kaspersky. And I think it's quite a honest support of him, because he really believes that internet should be governed by the state. And his experience inside the KGB helped him to believe in it, and that's the biggest problem with him. And for more detail, I think it's better to read this excellent profile on Wired.
Okay, then one last question, please.
What's about I2P in Russia? It seems to be very active. What about awareness of anonymous services?
About what?
Could you repeat that, please?
What's about I2P in Russia? It seems to be very active. And what's about awareness of anonymous services? Sorry.
About Tor again.
And, also Tor, yes, but I2P is also some form of anonymous peer-to-peer network.
It's not very popular, just because people don't need to. Well, actually, in Russia, people need such kind of services only when they try to access some things from the office computers. And only now, from November 1, they started to think about anonymizers, about all kind of proxy things, and about how to avoid such kind of control. So it's very new development for Russian customers, and they are very, to be frank, naive, and they don't actually understand how it might be. How might we help it, and how we might avoid such kind of control? And it's, in this case, they might be more naive than people in Uzbekistan, because in Uzbekistan, people already knew how to deal with the problem, but not in Russia.
Okay, then. Yeah, still have 3 minutes. So, if you have a short question left,
I have enough questions. If they sell technology to Mexico, can that technology also analyze the Spanish language content or only identified individuals?
This technology is very good. The problem is that the language is actually is not very important. They can analyze the physical capability of every man. And the problem that now we started to update the system of only speech recognition with the face recognition. And also the problem is that these people convinced the government of Mexico that the largest databases of speech examples should be collected to make this system operational. And that's why, for example, now all policemen are required to give the examples of a speech, ostensibly to fight corruption. And some states, some Mexican states, it's also the requirement for every citizen if the citizen wants to obtain the driving license. So it became quite a totalitarian thing. And the pretext is the fighting against corruption and the fighting against kidnapping. But in fact, what they got the system of identification of people by voice and by face on the nationwide scale. And Spanish language is developed the technologies for Chinese. Spanish is not a very big issue for them.
Okay, then. Thank you very much for your talk.
Thank you.
And very much.